If you need to use containers in your infrastructure, then OpenShift is one of the best ways to go. My name is Marcin Kubacki, I'm Chief Software Architect at Storware, and today I'm going to talk how to protect both containers and virtual machines running in your OpenShift. Okay, so let's start with logging into the console. So here is my Storware Backup and Recovery. And in the secondary tab, notice that I have my OpenShift. In the OpenShift, what we are actually want to see is the in the workloads tab, deployments. In this project, I don't have anything. So in this particular project, I will focus on this Ubuntu. Deployment config, stateful sets are also covered. We're not going to cover that in this particular video, but anyway, they are also supported. And then we have virtualization with virtual machines. So in the default project, you will see that there is also CentOS zeros that I'm going to protect. So with the Storware Backup and Recovery in the virtual environments tab, everything here is actually in the virtual environments instances tab. So both deployment, deployment config, stateful set will appear here as a protected entity. Now, by saying protected entity, it means that whenever you would like to protect a workload in the OpenShift, that's the level we are going to focus. So the metadata of the deployment and persistent volumes that are attached to the pods running inside this deployment. So not a namespace level, but the deployment or virtual machine level. Now, usually you start with the infrastructure tab and provide necessary credentials in here. So you just need to add here the appropriate hypervisor manager and then provide necessary credentials. So in this case, we have the Red Hat OpenShift. So that's the place where you provide the URL to the API and necessary information, especially node default configuration, because you can have multiple nodes that actually cover the backup process running in your OpenShift. Now, once you have done this part and you have run inventory synchronization, it submits a task. This task is later executed by one of your nodes. And this node collects all of the information about the networks, projects, and what is important, instances. So what I have already mentioned, that we have covered the deployments, deployment configs, that's your instance. And in my case, I have two of them, an example of the virtual machine and an example of the deployment already in there. In my task console, you can see that my inventory synchronization task has already complete, so it's up to date. And now I can run, let's say, a backup, for instance. Now, regarding the backup process, we use OADP to export metadata, but the actual data transfer occurs through the helper pod. So this helper pod attaches necessary persistent volumes and it dumps the data. Whenever it is possible, we try to use the snapshot feature that comes from the CSI driver. So if snapshot is doable, we will execute snapshot and we will dump the data from the attached snapshot. That's what is technically for the deployments, deployment configs and stateful sets. For these regular environments, we will have just full backup only option. If you'd like to use incremental for this free, you'd have to use ceph and attach it to the to your environment and provide the credentials here in the storage and storage providers section. So that is for ceph only. However, if you're going to protect virtual machines, like in my case, it's in the instances view, I have run right now incremental backup for my virtual machine. This, this helper pod actually has a service that is responsible for scanning for the changes, scanning for the necessary changes in your drives, in the individual drives. So you don't have to worry about supporting supported configurations in this case, because it's a generic mechanism. So we are creating a snapshot in this moment, and we are scanning for changes between and comparing the checksums against our database. So the incremental backup is supported in such scenario. It may not be that fast like in Ceph example, but still it at least is generic in this case, so you don't have to worry about the underlying storage. Now, if you take a look inside, notice that we also scan for hypervisor, well, we call them hypervisor tags, but these are basically the labels that come from your OpenShift environment. And we, if you scroll down a bit, you see that there is one drive in this case, it's a root disk, which is, well, this one is present, you can optionally exclude it. One note about disks regarding the virtual machines, it's a brand new feature coming with this release, and OpenShift supports hot add disks. These are unfortunately not automatically reflected in the main configuration, so in order for us to protect them, we would also need this virtual machine to be restarted eventually, because otherwise these drives won't be visible on the main list. Now, once you have inventory synchronization process in place, you can obviously run the backups, restores, and so on. And because we are comparing the checksums against our database, no snapshot needs to be kept on the OpenShift in this case. So my incremental backup has completed. Notice that this is a set of tasks, actually. So we have export that grabs data and puts it in the staging directory on the node, and later we push backups to one of the configured backup destinations that you have selected. If you have secondary backup destination enabled, you would see here also a secondary store task. Then obviously some cleanup tasks are being executed. And now, once we have done this part, we can restore the virtual machine, for instance, back. So let's try to restore it back to the hypervisor manager. Let's add it some restore, maybe two. Now you can specify which hypervisor manager, so which OpenShift environment you would like to restore to which project. We are going to keep the, well, I have only one in this environment, but you could specify a different one if you wish to. You need to specify which storage class needs to be used in that case, and which networking, because we have detected here that there is a network interface in this virtual machine attached. So summary, and we can just click restore. Restore process is obviously the opposite, so we'll have to restore back the files from your backup destination, S3 or whatever, and then put them on the staging space. If it's incremental, the increments may need to be merged. I said may need to be, because if you are using synthetic backup provider, the actual image would be already merged. So we have also support for synthetic backup destination available in here. If you're using either data domain with the BoostFS or XFS or NFS 4.2, then that is supported. And you could use that storage to have synthetic backup capability. So for a very incremental, and well, while not present in the OpenShift yet, some features like the instant recovery, they usually base on it. So that's a future-proof setup if you would like to choose one of the types of the backup destination. Now, the restore process has already completed, so it is going to import now. So that's the second step of the actual restore workflow. So here in the virtual machines, you will see additional virtual machine be present. I have one in here already. We can actually remove this one. It's no longer needed. Okay, in the meantime, we can actually investigate other details. So if you would like to verify which backups have failed or succeeded, here on the events calendar, you will see that there is a set of dots in here. You can filter all of the details using this filter, this calendar on the right, and see some backup statistics, especially maybe backup time. So in my case, notice that export actually is the part that takes longest. And here you can see my previous restores. So the restore process is pretty fast. This especially because it's a file system, it's local drive, and then it may take several minutes to the during the import phase. During the actual backup, we obviously read data using this proxy mechanism, sort of proxy, not VM in this case, but the deployment. So the data is being read directly from the same storage as your other virtual machines are running or the deployments. So it's from this point, it is Sun. So this moment is Sun-based. However, from this helper pod to the staging space, it is going through the LAN. So that part may be a bit more time-consuming. Now, mount operation is the other aspect that we can that you can do during the recovery. And for file-level recovery, we support everything except file-based persistent volume. So if you have a block device, persistent volume, then we are going to be able to mount that in using this third button here. And this is virtual machine, so usually you are going to attach rather the block device in this case. So we have this option to mount file systems automatically, specifies manually which file systems are going to be mounted, or sharing drives over iSCSI if you would like, for instance, to actually you can use Windows guest, if I recall correctly, on your OpenShift virtualization. So that would be also a perfect example for Windows guest, where you would like to preserve Windows file permissions. I have one already in here, so this is actually file automatic mount mode. So here in the browse, you can see that I see all of the files running in this particular image. So let's just restore maybe from the etc. Maybe you would like to just search for the fstab, and now you can just download. That's one of the options, and that is going to result in one in the archive. Or you may initiate remote upload. So if you have a host that where you would like just to upload these individual files and later do whatever you need to do with it, then we can use SSH or WinRM in this case to upload them. In the meantime, actually my restore has completed, so we can go back again to the virtual machines and notice that I have another virtual machine. Just now it has been created, so now I can power it on start. So the rest of the metadata is exactly the same like you would see in the regular virtual machine. So this is going to boot. So as you can see, it's successfully started. So now with the Storware Backup and Recovery, you have a wide range of options in terms of the backup destinations. So you have the option to specify file systems, especially check out the synthetic part. Some of them are specifically related to the air gap data protection, so that you are able to mount dynamically parts of your storage just to store these backups. Use, let's say, rubric managed volumes or catalogic vstore, for instance. But all of them are file system based. Permanently mounted synthetic backup destinations is one of the most commonly used options. You also are able to use object storage, especially cloud providers, where it may be useful, but some customers have already S3 compatible storage in object storage in their data center. So that's also an option for you. Or enterprise. So if you are using OpenShift virtualization environment, but still, if you are going, you have some IBM Dell's Veritas or Micro Focus solution in your environment, it can be extended with the Storware Backup and Recovery to cover it as well. Now, I have shown you a manual approach with backups, running backups and recovery with the Storware Backup and Recovery, but you probably are going to execute backups on by schedule rather, right? So in the virtual environments, notice that I have backup SLA. So that's the place where all of the magic happens. And in this SLA, you always need to assign some SLA in order for even for manual backups to work. But in this SLA, you define rules. And these rules specify where the backup needs to be stored, maybe in the secondary backup destination as well. So that's the option. For how long, for number of days, number of versions, and how often it's supposed to, also when the backups are going to be executed. You can also have multiple rules, and this is going to result in a separate export plus store workflow. So each rule corresponds to single export task. And primary and secondary backup destination, if it's secondary is enabled, then you would have just additional store task enabled. So this policy you could manually assign to your deployments, stateful sets, etc., or you can use automatic assignment. And because OpenShift supports tags or labels, then you can create rules like include exclude rules based on the presence of, let's say, a tag. And depending on the mode, the policy would be assigned only or assigned and removed if it no longer matches your rules. So that's the way to automate the assignment of your dynamically environments that are often being created without the knowledge of the administrator. And at some point, you may also want to test periodically if your environments are restorable. So in the recovery plan section, it's a different kind of the policy. You can define, let's say, the OpenShift recovery plan. And now you can add rules. And these rules specify which virtual environments. Rule obviously is limited to the specific type of the source. So if you have, let's say, virtual machines coming from REF, from the OpenShift virtualization, from the VMware, etc., then it's actually you need to define separate rules because they have different parameters. But in my case, I have only one environment, so that simplifies a lot. I can specify which environments according to which schedules. That's optional because you may want also to invoke recovery plan, a batch restore actually, for all of your virtual machines, deployments, and so on, based on the schedules or manually, right? And now, restore parameters, they are roughly the same as you would see in the restore window with the option to specify some prefix or suffix for the name, some kind of mapping of the of the names. If you would like to specify to which project they are supposed to be attached. So that's kind of the parameters that you would see. Now, you don't specify a specific backup. You will provide the information just that you would like to restore last successful backup or last regardless of status. If you would like, for instance, to explicitly fail on whenever your last backup was not successful, and that's a validation, so you would like to have that in the report, okay? Because otherwise, your restore would succeed. It would just take the previous successful backup, and in last, regardless of status, will explicitly fail because your last backup is in the failed state. And that concludes my demo. As you can see, with Store Backup and Recovery, you can easily protect deployments, deployment configs, virtual machines, and stateful sets running in your OpenShift environment. Thank you for watching and stay tuned for the other videos.